intersections with the talk of intersections of some functions from Brownian motion and Carnot group. Alexey, please.
Yes, thank you very much. Just give me a second and show my screen. Okay. So now you should see the title of my talk.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. So the talk will be about multiple intersections for functions of Brownian motion in Carnot group. So let me start from the beginning. What I mean by Carnot group is some Lie group, which can be seen as just RD, real numbers, with some operation which is group operation and which is smooth in the sense of differentiation. So this is Lie group, and then on this Lie group there is an operation which is called sometimes dilations, which sends which multiplies each coordinate by constant by in different powers. And this operation is such that it is related with group, so it is automorphism. So I can write, so this means that we can act either before or after addition and it is the same. So a lot follows from this, for example, that the group operation is polynomial, and all this by basis in the algebra can also polynomial. And additional property that I need is below, it is a version of Hermander condition for the vector fields L1, LK. So this vector fields generate with the commutators the whole RD at each point. This is also the condition needed for this to be a Carnot group. So if all this satisfies, then it is a Carnot group. So this is what I consider, and on this Carnot group we can define. Okay, we can define this XT on RD, but the resulting process is what is called Brownian motion in a Lie group, with basis Lie group being the Carnot group from the previous slide. So the definition is as follows: we take differential equation and use as coefficients near dwi vector fields from our Lie algebra, but only those which correspond to powers one in this automorphism. So we only have k first coordinates that have power one, and this k coordinates correspond exactly to first k vector fields, and this first vector fields has to generate whole RD as commutators, and this exactly those k vector fields that is in the equation. So this is how the process is defined. And simple example. So Brownian motion three-dimensional Heisenberg group is just Brownian motion in two dimensions plus additional coordinate Lie vector. This of course only one of the examples. Different versions of this are possible, and in higher dimensions I will have higher order integrals, iterated integrals from the Brownian motion. This is what usually obtain when we can always solve this equation like triangular equation. So there's always few equations that just give Brownian motions, and then the rest of them just simply integrals. There is no problem with solution again. And such processes were considered by Ito first in his paper Brownian motions in Li group. And for me, it is important that it is not just some processes, it is kind of a model processes for general hyperelliptic diffusions, so to speak. So for general diffusions that is not necessarily have ellipticity conditions. The corresponding operator is hyperelliptic, which means that we have a smooth density for this process. And so what is important is that there was a paper in 1976, which basically shown that it's possible to work with general hyperelliptic differential operators only by living on nilpotent Lie groups and then doing some kind of procedure of approximation, which is not trivial, but it's outside of scope of what I'm talking about. I'll be only talking about these processes, but this processes is kind of model processes for a general diffusion. So okay. And so what I'm going to do, I'm going to study what I call multiple intersections. So this is a probability such that some function from different point of processes, and I also take different functions. This more interesting this way. I will show you why later. And if we have different functions, but fixed functions, we can ask a question whether such points that all values function of values of x in different points of time are the same. And for again, since the case of equal functions is included, to make it interesting, I also have a condition that times should not be equal. As you can see, I can also just take the times from different time intervals if I want to. But it's right now it doesn't matter. So this is what I want to study. So for which G and Fi, we have this probability positive. So today I'm going to give you some positive answers. So we have some condition under which it is true. And to do that, okay, first I recall the history a little bit. So of course, yes, as you know, so Brownian motion in two dimensions has intersections of any multiplicity, but Brownian motion in R3 has only self intersections, but actually no, it is not the result probably of Dvoretsky, but maybe, okay, I don't know, but it is true that in R3, the Brownian motion has no intersection, threefold intersection and so on. But in Brownian motion in R4 has no self-intersection at all. So the dimension is very important. The higher the dimension, the less, intersections we have, so to speak, yes. It is interesting, why it is interesting to consider not necessarily elliptic process, because it turns out, as it was proved in the paper of Chalet, Morel, and Legal, that there is a three-dimensional process that has no self-intersection. So it is, you see, the Brownian motion has self-intersection, but if we take this process that I showed you before, so instead of third Brownian motion, we take Levy area. Turns out this process already does not have self-intersections, but it is still hyperelliptic, that it has smooth density and so on. So there is some difference between usual Brownian motions and hyperelliptic processes. In fact, Legal proved a little bit more. They considered a larger class of hyperelliptic processes, but they were somewhat similar to Brownian motion of three-dimensional Heisenberg group. So only for these processes we have no self-intersections. I also have some results. And I already need the definition for the future. So let me discuss this first. What is MFX? This is a minimum of all. This correspond to LIQ. This was number that correspond to LIQ, or it was exactly the powers in which which are I might multiply a corresponding coordinate. As you recall, this was in dilations. In dilations, I have to multiply this coordinate by this power. So this is a power that corresponds to a coordinate and corresponds to vector field. And I take a minimum of such sums such that corresponding vector fields acting in function f give linearly independent family. What does it mean? It means that this, if we have surface fx equal to some u, doesn't matter, then and we take a point x on the surface, right? So and we look at vector fields that go outside of this surface. So suppose L1 or L8, I don't know, there are some vector fields that go outside in a sense. So if we take take this vector field as vector and multiply it by the gradient of f, this will be what we get here. And so we kind of make sure that this vector field, together with the tangent space, they have full RD. Yeah, so this is the condition. And this it is important which powers correspond to such vector fields. Yes, so this is in case of standard Brownian motion, when all avance, this is just equal to the dimension of the image of f, right? So this was the dimension of fxt, so the dimension of our processes which we seek intersections, you know. And this is, you can call it homogeneous dimension of such processes, because it also takes into account some powers which related to the structure of the process. And it turns out it is relevant in a sense, so that if I can say that if such MF is less than 4 or less than equal than 3, which is the same because they're integer in the case of these processes, then it is sufficient condition for existence of self-intersection. Moreover, if it is less than 3, so it's 1 or 2, then it's sufficient condition for the existence of n-fold self-intersections. Why? Okay, so generally, it is interesting that MF MF can be defined for more general processes. That's why this condition is more interesting in a form in this form. So this is the condition if for MF in more general for more general processes, where n is again is multiplicity of intersections. So this is exactly the condition, and it projects in this condition for case when MF is integer. And this is a condition was proved in my paper recently for the existence of such self-intersection. It turns out that this condition is not necessary. There are some processes that have self-intersection but does not satisfy the first condition. So it is the reason of this investigation. I want to give a more precise condition, and today I will give more precise condition for n-folds of intersections in the case when m equal to 2. But for I need a little bit more preparation. I need what is regular point. Regular point is such point that this homogeneous dimension does not change in the neighborhood of this point. So what can happen is sometimes some vector can become parallel to the surface, and if this was one vector at one point, only at one point, but you know, neighborhood points, it will be not parallel. No, but so in this point, this vector cannot be included in this set, so it changes the MF exactly at this point. and this is bad, and we want to exclude this case. So this is why this condition.
Mm-hmm.
And this proposition is just an application. By, okay, so if it's regular point, so at least if m equal to 2, then we can say that one of the vectors that goes outside have to correspond to the degree 1. This mm-hmm. one of them for sure have to
correspond. Alexey, let me ask you what happened with the image points. For example, you have this regular point, and you consider the surface in this. You consider the point f of x and f of y. So they are close one to another. What happened in those space? Can we say that something like similar, like Sartre theorem or something happens? Because you consider actually the process f of x. And
yes, but I do not understand the question. What do you want to happen exactly with the process?
For example, if we have a smooth mapping, yes, and we know that this is mapping from Rm to Rm with the same dimension, and we consider the points in the image such that the determinant of the derivative is equal to zero, then the measure of such points by the Sartre theorem is zero. What happened here with these points? Because you see, you consider the finally, the process f of x, and it is natural to characterize the points in the Rm where this process lives.
Yes, but for now, I need to work in the original space, because I have the process in original space, which I know something about. I know its density, so I integrate over original space. And that is why I need to know. You're right, Sartre theorem tells us about the image, but not about the origin, unfortunately.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, so this is why Sartre theorem is not directly applicable here.
Yes, I understand, but you know, of course, your process even is not Markovian and so on. But still, it's for example, it seems that it has density.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, and maybe this density satisfies something. So it will be interesting to say these are some, say in brackets, critical points or something for this process inside Rm already. Yeah. But okay.
Yes, but I don't know, because yeah, the process is again a little bit different from the just geometrical description that I'm talking mm-hmm. about. So let us go
mm-hmm.
to the theorem. Yeah. So the theorem is as follows. Of course, I consider case m equal to 2, and I introduce such values qj. Well, this is basically if we have two L1 and Li1 and Li2 is two vector fields that go outside the surface. There's two vector fields that I was talking about. One of them have a corresponding degree 1, and the other have this degree qj that I'm qj. J is the index of the surface. So is this correspond to the fj? So this is qj. And then the condition is the sum of 1 over qj has to be greater than n minus 2. And under this condition, we have unfold self-intersections. Again, x has to be regular for all fi, fj. So let me speak about this condition a little bit. So first of all, obviously, if n equal to 2, then it always satisfied. I think it can even be simplified, this condition, right? Because if all if only only three of the q's can be non-equal to one. So we know that all q are integers. Okay, in fact, we know that all q's can be arbitrary positive integers. So I have examples, so I can say that they can be arbitrary, but for now it is important that if at least four of them are different from one, then we have at least four one halves, right? So then we have the sum of four of the quantities here will be two, but some of the rest is not bigger than n minus four. Yeah, so we already don't have n minus two. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So only three of them can be different from one. And if and notice that if one equal to one, then it doesn't matter. We can just erase it and look on the condition for the rest. So if qn equal to one, that means that the same condition has to hold for q1 to up to qn minus one. It has to be greater than n minus three. So it's kind of interesting that it once erased themselves from the condition, and the rest of them, the rest cannot be more than three different values here, not equal to one. So it also means, for example, that if all q are equal, then the intersections here, the conditions here only possible if q equal to one for a chain. So it's not very interesting with the same functions that was I was saying before. So this is a condition. So let me go.
Alexey, before you go to the you go further, even in the case when all q equals to one, we have a usual Brownian motion, as I think.
Yes. Maybe not exactly, but something similar to it. So
yes. So your statement will look as follows: you can take different f. Yes. For example, you can take different pairs of coordinates. I think for initial. Initial process, mm-hmm. And then you will say that this pairs of coordinates will coincide. Yeah,
mm-hmm.
Interesting. So it seems to me that even for usual Brownian motion, it will be interesting to play with this function f1 fn and get some.
Well, it is not critical that I take here the same process. I can as you can see from the next slides, I can just take independent processes here.
It will be known, but here
it's the same because I will take different time intervals, so they will be essentially independent.
So
it doesn't matter if they're the same if we can just take different intervals far mm-hmm. away. So
okay, mm-hmm. I see.
So the main idea, of course, is to use such estimate for the density, which is well known. I'm sorry, I did not write here important. No, this is not Nagelstein, but other paper by Varopoulos and some other authors. There is a book which describes. Describes estimates for fundamental solutions of such operators of this form that I consider two on nilpotent groups. So for nilpotent groups, such estimate is known, where rho is corresponding distance that can be constructed using vector fields API in the following form. So you see the PI is present here as bound We can move in the direction of Li with the speed no faster than delta power Pi. So Pi is also controls the speed of in this direction. So this is why it is important to look, do we have directions with this speed or maybe different speed outside the surface. And so main idea is to construct a local time. If we can construct local time, and if it's local time is not zero, then it is well known argument that then we must have some corresponding intersections. So this is exactly what I'm doing here. I'm constructing such local time, and like I said, I take intervals of time that do not intersect each other, right? So this is the main trick here. It simplifies the condition significantly. And, it's easier to do like this. I still get positive result. This is what I will do, and this will be done using again my result from my paper that I already shown to you reference to, and using this theorem I prove the following theorem. Let me take measure nu as a surface measure on such surface. It's a measure on the surface where all difference between functions are fixed, values of functions are fixed. Of course, in the case when it's zero, this is exactly the surface on which we look for intersections. But I need to change this one from zero a little bit so that I can prove the theorem. So you see, I take their supremum over U small of such integral, and in this integral we have surface measure on this surface, and I have to integrate two times this, because this is basically two conditions. There are two integrals. And under these conditions, we have the convergence of gamma epsilon from previous slide. So there are some technical conditions, but they're easily checked in this case. So it is just follows from the previous theorem. I need some constructions just to explain what I'm doing next. So basically, the idea is as follows: we can look for we can look for intersections surface with a ball and do the following. We parameterize the surface. So theta is a parameter of the surface, parameterization of the surface. And then U is exactly the value of f at the surface. Right now it's surface fx equal to u. This is simple surface. And then I claim that I can write all the points on the surface inside the ball as follows, as some functions, and we control to be inside the ball, we have to control parameters. First of all, we have to control parameters of the surface, and then we have to control additional parameters, additional set of parameters. But this is just a function from the rest, so it is kind of. So what I do here, I take exponential map, then I take do some change of variables, and then I obtain this. So it is possible to do for regular points. For regular points, moreover, in some neighborhood of regular points. So for each point in the neighborhood of regular point, we can do this. So if I do this for each, as you can see, this big surface from the previous slide actually can be viewed as some union of this Descartes product of the more simple surfaces of the form f I x equal to some value ci. This big surface is just a union of some Descartes product of simple. So this is why here I can use this, and I can write this. I have additional index q that goes over surfaces, goes over different surfaces for different functions. So I just add additional q, write this down, and here this is the part that relates all this, which basically says that we're on this such big surface. And this is what I need to bound. So my goal was to represent this integral as bound of Lebesgue measure of some function less than some epsilons. So when I do it in this form, now I have some useful lemmas that I can apply. For example, if this function has linear growth, yes, in all directions, so then this is just simple product of this epsilon. Different products of this epsilon will be our estimate from above. It is very simple, and this is what I've done in my previous paper. I just use linear estimate. But the problem here is that there is a singularity, so there will be some directions in which behavior is not linear. So I need the following lemma. So what's this lemma about? Okay, as you can see, what I'm studying Lebesgue measure of some function less than epsilon I. So this is the same that was on previous slide in general form. This is what I study. I also add conditions that some delta, so that we live in some small neighborhood of zero. And then the problem with function ji that the derivative by x has rank n minus one instead of having rank n. If it had rank n, we could just say that this is just product of epsilon I. Very simple reasons, we can just make change of variables in a small neighborhood of zero, right? But now we cannot do this because of singularity in the derivative. But there is a condition on the second derivative here. So we have some second derivative which is non-zero, and moreover, it non-zero in the direction which is outside of the space of the linear subspace generated by a first derivative. So it goes outside the subspace, and so this second derivative is what defines the behavior of these functions in this singular direction. And this lemma says that if we also integrate over A, here A acts as a parameter, but we also integrate over it. It also included in the integral here. So we integrate over parameter A. And here you see that the second derivative is over parameter A. So basically what we have is we have that this singularity, it disappears if this parameter A changes in some direction. So we have some surface, right? And we have this vector that goes outside. It's at some point it goes parallel. but only at one point, and there are a lot of neighborhood points where it's not. So the singularity only exists for some values of parameter, for value of parameter zero, actually. And it does not exist for all other values of parameters. Disappears in so what happens here is this singularity is getting integrated, so getting smoothed, so to speak, and turns out that it adds additional logarithm but no more to the estimate. So this is actually have some relations, I believe has some relation to Morse functions, but I just can't explain it. But the proof basically here is that I have to represent some of the function as a difference of some two functions in some forms. So this is the function becomes new variables, and then we can make estimates. This is very similar how Morse functions work, right? So maybe I can even apply it. So Morse function, Morse lemma, yes. So if we have a singularity, a function with singularity, but this its second derivative is non-trivial, then we can always represent this function in the neighborhood of this point as sum of squares with plus or minuses of some variables. So in this case, it will be only minus because of this condition. It cannot be no plus because of this condition. Okay. So this is the main lemma. And then if I apply this lemma, then I can estimate my integral. And okay, I'm coming very close to the end. So here, the estimate has the following form. We have to choose two indices, S1 and S2. And these two indices, they have corresponding multipliers. This corresponds to the selection of from this function H. From this function H, I select two functions, and these two functions I use this lemma, and then I get such estimate. But I can do it for important. It is important, so I can do it for any pair of such functions. So what I get is not one estimate, but a lot of estimates. So in fact, I get the following estimate. So this integral, I also multiply it right away by this. It is what was in the condition. In the condition, we had such multiplication. That's why I added here, and then I obtain the following. That this is less than equal constant minimum sum product of powers of epsilon n, and powers can be like follows. So if we select two again S1 and S2, then corresponding powers is basically zero minus alpha means alpha is small. So minus alpha basically means that very small negative values. And the rest is just correspond to QL, which is what can be calculated. So this is the estimate. And then I apply following lemma. This is an interesting lemma, so I think I presented. So it is lemma from the same paper, my previous paper on this topic. And it provides the condition for the integrability of such of exactly this form of integral. And the condition is as follows. We have to add one to all these powers. And then the integral is finite if only if for any such lambda, which are not all zero, but non-negative, there exists one of the set of powers such that this is positive. It is the condition. The proof is just I take logarithm and then look in different directions. So basically L1 in LP is a direction in which we go from zero, and we have to make sure there's this integrability in all directions, basically. So this is it. And Yes, so how to rewrite it? How to rewrite this condition in this case? Okay, so the condition is as follows. So we have to input here this BI from the two slides before. So I do this. So I obtain the following. And then I do some change. I change lambda to lambda tilde. So that, and I assume that lambda tilde is one. It doesn't matter because the condition is homogeneous in lambda. And now we have the following condition. So for S1, for fixed S1 and S2, I have the following condition that needs to be satisfied. So there must exist such S1 and S2 such that this condition is satisfied. And then, yes, so another lemma for basically finishes the proof. So it turns out that this general problem has the following solution. And this solution can be rewritten as this. And this is already the condition from the theorem. So in this way, using this lemma, we already, in this estimate, we already obtain our result. So I don't know. I do not have anything significant to tell, but maybe there are some questions. So I'm more details about things.
Okay, thank you very much. And actually I have a question related to your definition of the local time, because you use the surfaces like f2 from xt2 minus f1 from xt1 equal u1 and so on. So maybe since you can prove the existence of the local time in some sense, then maybe you can speak about the properties of visitation measure for, or occupation measure for those for those set of differences. It can be interesting because it is related to, as we said in the beginning, when you will choose different F1, F2, Fn, you will get something about the geometry of this, of the process X itself.
What kind of properties do you think is interesting?
Oh, I think, you see, we already discussed this Minkowski functionals, and this functions F1 and so on looks like projections in two dimensions. And now you can say something about the occupation measure for this set of differences. It means that you can say something about three, four-dimensional things, projections related to the process X. You don't say that it has itself, it has multiple self-intersection, and it is not true as you showed us in the first slides, but you still will know something about such generalized projections, and maybe it can be it can help to define such kinds like Minkowski functionals.
Minkowski functional. What exactly do you mean by Minkowski functional now? For what?
For trajectory of the X.
What is Minkowski functional for trajectory?
For the set, we just
as for the set.
Yes, as for the set. Yeah.
And
we take some projections and define. For projections, define the Minkowski functionals, and then integrate over all all hyperplanes in which we project. And as we know, for two-dimensional Wiener process and process like Wiener process. We have this local time of self-regularized local time of self-intersections like Minkowski functionals. So
you mean you have to take the tube and then take it to zero? Yes.
So maybe from this point of view, you can begin to discuss this problem for this process. Yeah.
Okay. Yes. Maybe I have to think about samples.
Okay. Maybe some other questions or comments, please. Okay, so thank you for interesting talk. And our next speaker will be Max von Renesse. Maybe we will organize his talk. He will visit us next week. So maybe we will organize his talk in usual room at the Institute of Mathematics, but still Zoom also will be available. So we will have next meeting partially by alive persons, partially by virtual persons. Okay, see you next week. Bye.
Thank you.